But I'm going to start from the beginning.
Yeah.
So you grew up in New York.
Yeah.
And you attended ballet and danced.
No.
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 Okay. I'm going to tear up my notes now.
I was not allowed to. I was told I wanted to tap because I had seen a lot of Fred Astaire on TV. And my mother pronounced rather archly, tapping is for gypsies. And she didn't realize it actually in Broadway terms it is. You know what I mean? So I was allowed to do ballroom dancing. Mm-hmm. Unbeknownst to my mother, though, I was winning a lot of dance contests in high school, you know, the twist and the mashed potatoes were two of my, you know.
And how old were you then?
I must have been 13.
Right.
Yeah. And then I got a hold of a fake identification, not to buy alcohol, as one would suppose, but so I could get into this fantastic club. And my goal was to get up on that box and shake my booty, which I did. Yeah, so it was fun. And then I went to college, and my rather unfit, I'll just say it that way, roommates, I said, oh, where are you going now? He said, I'm going to dance class. And I was like, what? And he and this other guy, Jack, who is about 7 feet tall, and I said, I have to see that. And then I went and watched them, you know, do this class, and I went, I can do that.
Like that. Like a chorus line.
Yeah, I know, totally. Yeah. So, and then I started doing that.
And that was ballet?
That was ballet and Martha Graham.
Right.
At the same time.
Yeah. And then when did you join a ballet school, or did you go straight into a
They actually stuck me in a, I was in the university, I was in the dance program there, and then there was a regional company. America, do they still have those here? Regional ballets?
Yes.
Yeah? They're great. I loved them. Yeah. And you go to these big competitions, whatever, and or conferences, and you show your pieces, and you take class in a big on carpeting with 1,000 other dancers.
Yes, actually, yeah. I taught at one.
Yeah, there you go. So I did that, and then I got a scholarship to Joffrey.
And then Joffrey at that time was with Arpino and Joffrey, and it was in a huge creative hub.
It was crazy.
And you joined the company?
No, at first I was just, you know, a scholarship student, and then they created the second company.
Uh-huh.
And we were basically the resident company of the New York City Opera. Plus, we had to go on tour, it seemed like for an eternity, yeah. Right. But we got to do pretty much all the repertory, or a lot of the repertory that the main company did.
Right.
They didn't want us, I guess, secure rights for separate pieces. But occasionally, some very interesting, oh, I'm sorry about that.
Very unprofessional of me.
Yeah. I'm good, all right?
Okay.
Yeah. And then I worked with a very interesting Japanese choreographer whose son's in the Australian Ballet, actually. And then, let me think. So we did that, and then I was taken into the main company. And then I injured myself from being on tour all day with the second company still, and then at night having to do 3 ballets.
Right.
So I did 12 performances in one day. And yeah, and you can do that when you're 19, I think. Yeah, but not 19 and a half. So it went bang like that, but it wasn't that bad. And they said, oh, so when are you coming back? And I thought, I'm not. I thought that they were unfair to me as employers. And I thought that, just sort of a labor common sense. I was like, wait a minute, this doesn't seem like a big career trajectory
right.
if I'm going sprung at this age. So I said, no, and I went freelance. And then I auditioned for Stuttgart.
Yeah.
Ballet.
And that was with Marcia, was there as director at the time?
Yeah.
And it seemed like that company was also a hub of creative talent. There's lots of great choreographers come out of that company.
Amazing, yeah. That was their mantra, though.
Like, to create.
Yes, they had this program called the Novarre Society. Jean-Georges Novarre was a choreographer in the 18th century, also in Stuttgart, and they had a foundation. And they rented the opera house every year. And anyone could apply to do a choreography in the company, but also around Germany.
Right.
Yeah. And I got to do a piece, and the next day I was the resident choreographer of Stuttgart.
Oh, wow. Yeah. That was Boom. Fast. Yeah. And how long were you dancing there for?
Oh, I guess about 10 years.
Oh, a long time. Yeah.
So,
and you did a lot of the rep that we have familiar here, because we have done on Yagin and Taming of the Shrew. Mm-hmm. Cranko had already passed by the time.
Cranko hired me and died.
Oh.
It sounds terrible, but he died on the plane on the way back. It was an audition. It was 250 boys at the Met in that big room downstairs.
250
boys. It was, and I have never, ever, again, done six pirouettes and stopped on demi-point, triple ensemble. I've never done that. I never did it again in my entire career, but that audition I did. And my fate was then sealed.
And they had an American tour or something, Stuttgart?
It was Saul Hurach, who was touring the Bolshoi Stuttgart. Saul Hurach was the big Columbia
presenter.
Artist. Yeah, presenter. And he took all these big European companies. That's why I saw the Bolshoi, for example, do all their stuff. When I was a kid. And so, we were all part of that.
So during that time, also with Joffrey before leaving, New York had a lot of contemporary dance that was bubbling and coming to the top.
It was incredible.
So
it was a boom, right? It began at the beginning of the 70s.
Do you remember some pieces or some moments that really impacted you?
I saw it from a choreographer whose name you don't hear so much, Paul Sanasardo. Mm-hmm. He had... I think he'd worked, I can't quite remember. Does anyone know that name? See, there you go. I saw, there was a telephone pole in the middle of the stage, and it was on a pivot. So telephone poles are big, you know what I mean? It took up the entire stage, and it was going like this the whole time. And they had to perform this piece with this telephone pole doing that. It was crazy. I was like, And of course, I got to go to see Balanchine every single night for $1. Yeah, that was student price, $1, and you sat in the first ring in the seats of the directors because they were backstage. Uh-huh. He never liked to watch from the front. So,
and then you danced in Stuttgart for 10 years, you said?
Yeah.
And then you became artistic director of Frankfurt Ballet.
No, I left Stuttgart and then I freelanced and... was more or less resident at NDT.
Oh, right.
Yuri Killian's company, Because Yuri had done his first ballets on me.
And he'd been in Stuttgart.
Stuttgart,
too.
So we're at the same dressing room table.
He was there.
Yeah, putting on our stuff.
Yeah. We have a lot of Yuri Killian ballets here, which I think the audience know.
Yeah.
And then so you freelanced for a while and was resident choreographer for NDT?
Yeah.
And then became artistic director.
And then became, and it was because of a piece I did for NDT. They came and saw that in Frankfurt. The Frankfurt dramaturgs came and saw it, and they said, would you like to do a full evening piece for us?
Wow.
And I made this piece called Gänge, which means sort of going, ways to go. And then they said, do you want to be director? And I said, yes. Yeah.
And that's a different job altogether, too, because once you're a director, you have management and
can we talk?
But you were there for a very long time.
I was there a total of 33 years.
Right.
Yeah.
And during that time, Artifact, which is the ballet that we're going to see, was
first, the first full length
right.
that I did there. Yeah.
The first one?
Yeah.
Oh,
I had to make it in 3 weeks.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah.
The whole ballet.
Yeah.
Well, when you see it, you'll understand why that's shocking, because the complexity of just one
but
section...
But there's a caveat, though. Oh. Okay, I had to make it in 3 weeks. I changed it for 30 years. I fixed it for 30 years. I'm still fixing it. And there are certain things I wanted to do, but I didn't have the skill back then. You know what I mean? I was, 30... four and a lot of desire, but really, I had to admit, not the craftsmanship to get it done,
And how did you, first, can you tell us about the entire piece? What was the...
Okay, you're going to see Artifact Suite, which is all sort of the dance highlights from the full evening piece, right? The full evening piece has two actors
mm-hmm.
who Were patterned after an idea from Lincoln Kirsten. When he, there's a famous book that's illustrated, Muriel Stewart's, with illustrations by Carlos Dwyer of all the ballet positions, and they're all sort of geometrically analyzed, and it's an exquisite book. It really is amazing. It's almost, it's not true and it is true. You know, it's all the possible rotations in every position. It's a magnificent work. It's called The Classical Ballet, and the introduction is written by Lincoln Kirsten, mm-hmm. who was Balanchine's great mezzain, what do you call, supporter. Yeah, he's the one that found all the support for Balanchine in America. He believed in him. And he talks about ballet, the history of ballet, and talks about the emancipation of ballet from opera. And that particular passage struck me about how ballet finally needed to move away from illustrating other people's stories.
Right.
And that's what Artifact is. It's a story of ballet's relationship with itself.
Right. Yeah. Like a reflection in
yes.
a way.
Yes, yeah.
And then, so there was two pieces or three?
Artifact is four.
Okay.
So there's the first act, which is almost like an operetta in a uh-huh. certain way.
Costumed and...
Well, it's recitativo. Yeah, there's a woman has a great big 18th century dress, and there's a guy with a white shirt on and a megaphone, and he only speaks through the megaphone. He's sort of a contemporary threat.
And do you write all that dialogue yourself?
I wrote all that, yes.
Oh, wow.
And the first cast was Australian, oh, Emily Bayard.
So thick accent.
right. Yeah. And... it was, I could say, it was a story ballet, but it was more like a poem than prose, so to speak. And what it did, all the language was recombinative, as the steps all are. So in ballet, you know, we just recombine existing things. You don't really change anything. You just find another way to make it relate to its other parts. Yeah. So it tried to treat language that way, mm-hmm. and yeah.
And then there's the section that we see.
Section you see, okay. So it starts with this big first act, which is, like I say, this opera, and all the speaking of this woman in this big historical dress is all metered. And it's all, the chaconne, which plays the violin, the D minor chaconne from Bach, which is many, many people know, is the musical themes that are presented in part one, and the Busoni transcription of the Bach part, chaconne, is the music that is used to accompany the speaker in a recitativo, like in opera, like in Mozart, for example, her speaking.
Right.
So it refers to all these epochs of theater and relationships to music, but she speaks in this recombinative style.
And have you ever said it as a full piece?
Oh yeah.
When was the last time? Flanders?
Flanders is the last one that did a Kathy Bennett.
Yeah, and I think they toured it. And,
yeah. Yeah.
And then the last part is the acting part, or did you finish with
that? There's actors and dancers, like major, first act. Then there's the second act, which is your first act, right? Starts with the second act here. Then there's this absolutely insane third act, which is, how can I describe it? I won't.
Can you describe the music of that?
A third act?
Yeah.
Yeah. A series of cannon explosions in the background and the sound of someone building a house.
Right.
With a hammer. Seriously.
Yeah. I believe you. Yeah.
And then the last part is more variations, which starts the way the second act starts.
All that.
Yeah, yes. So you get a lot of the last act, yeah.
And can you explain the music of the last act? Because that's
again, so variations on the chaconne, on the Bach chaconne.
Improvised. Yeah.
They were improvised. We've set them a bit more now because other pianists have to play them. They are improvised variations. Ava, the composer, was from Juilliard.
Right.
And she was really a piano virtuoso. She was extraordinary.
And then, so when you say it's improvised musically, there's still the structure of the counting.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There's very, very, very clear. Right. It's like you have a figure and you can do this with it or you can do that with it and so on and so forth, or you can syncopate it in a particular way, but there's a style of that.
Right.
You can't just go off and
do anything, not jazz.
There'll be a lot of tears on stage.
Yes, and then what about with the piece, the use of improvisation within the ballet structure itself?
Very little.
Very little. What about in the creation of it?
Tons.
Right.
Yeah. Because in 3 weeks, you go, okay, here's your theme, and here we go. You know? And that was things that are now the men's, like the solo, the two men at the end of the first act. Those were completely improvised on stage. And sometimes it was amazing, and sometimes it was terrible. I just want to point that out. That's the great thing about improvisation is that it can go. And it was fairly new. We hadn't really codified, however you say, our improvisational work, which I did over the next 30 years. Mm-hmm. So it was a really risky thing. And if someone had a knack for it, it was great. But if they didn't, it was really challenging. For them, too, it was a nightmare.
Could you explain that theory a little bit to us? I mean, for people that don't understand, they think of ballet as being incredibly structured, which we are.
It is. But, okay, let's see how sticky this is. I have to be careful. It's a little sticky. So I can, as I do this, right, I'm sorry, drag my foot there. I can simply talk and do ballet, right? I can't really not do that in a certain way, right? I can bum whatever you want me to do, you know? Ta-da, yee, bum, bum, yee, dum, ba-dum, et cetera. It's something that once you reach a certain level, it's like talking, yeah? And so you say, oh, well, you need to include these kind of figures. You know, and say, I want lots of pas mâché. This is a step, pas mâché goes like this. Bum, 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 bum. They all have names, you know that, right? Like you. So you say, okay, this section should include pas mâché and a balancé, but I need you to do keep your arms. So during the pas mâché, keep your arms rotating overhead. And then balancé, and I need a jeté, going to that. So you can go, ba di da da ba bi ka ba ba di ka balancé da da ba ba. And they can handle it because it's stuff we know.
Do you see how beautifully he dances? When you're in the rehearsal room, you still have to get over the shock of that before you start.
I'm trying to do less. That's my legs hanging over here because I'm like, oh God. I was at a wedding in Vail, and I think I danced too much at 11,000 feet. That was a mistake. Oh my God.
Do you find over time with the ballet that you do clearly refine it and change it down? Is the improvisation then become set? So when someone like Kathy comes, how much?
No,
how
no. Much I over the years, I improvised because we literally had 3 weeks to do it.
Right.
For the non-practitioners, a full length in 3 weeks is sounds like an oxymoron.
Yeah, it's impossible.
Yeah, it's like giant shrimp, yeah, right. Which appear on the menu apparently a lot. Yeah, so it's just not possible, really. You know, a ballet, I think, and because there's too much details. There's too many important details that need to get communicated in any ballet.
Well, and one of the great things that I love about this piece is the ensemble and the use of ensemble. And to me, when I watch your work, I can see a level of math like computer code zooming through decisions, and I try to chase after your decisions in my own head, if that makes sense. Is math, how much do you work out before you start that?
Nothing.
So it's all just
nothing.
Free?
You have to look at the people in front of you. I can practice on my own. So I practice a lot. Like I just did a piece in Paris, and I practiced for 3 years straight on my own, like nonstop. So when I walked into the room, I was prepared for whatever was going to happen. I came with an idea. I saw, okay, how is this idea being taken up? Yay, nay, you know? And then looked at people's skill sets and then it's very organic. Mm-hmm. It just comes out of, you're there and you go, whoa, wait a minute, no, you guys, I see, no, do, you know, you see, you have to, be really observant, I think. You have to really pay attention if you're going to work that way. Other people don't like to work that way. No, Alexei doesn't work that
everyone
way.
Everyone is very different. Yeah. And I mean, for me, it's like when I watch Serenade, that there's a sense of how the shape moves within itself.
I studied, for example, talking about preparing, every morning I had to get on the elliptical, right? And I would take my big phone, I'd put it like that, and I'd watch Theme and Variations and Serenade.
Right. Yep.
Because these are two ballets by Balanchine, and they are paradigmatic. They're the most extraordinary models of ballet I think I can even think of. And it was just, the thing is, you always have to remember you're always going to be a student.
Yeah, you have to learn.
There's no real mastery at one point. The more you know, you go like, oh my God, you know, so. But this is, you know, at one hand, me at the beginning of my career, Artifact. So it's really, I never changed the pas de deux, really. Those stayed.
So in the beginning of the ballet, there are two very strong pas de deux that seem highly emotional in a way.
Really?
To me, yeah. Okay. I don't know why. Maybe it's the music.
Yeah. Good.
But I certainly have an emotional reaction when I watch
nice.
It.
That's
it's
nice.
Like the girl that does the step.
Oh, yeah.
And sometimes the emotion is as a dancer, which I think is what you were talking about. You remember the fear of dancing and how it is to make a shape.
Oh, you understand how difficult some of this stuff. You're like,
And that's the emotion of it, because they're sort of aware of themselves and having a communication with their partner. And can you talk about the pas de deux and what was your inspiration for starting?
What was the music? I grew up playing the violin and bassoon and flute, and I sang in choruses. And I think that was probably the only reason I went to church, but it was because I got to sing, you know. But it was, my grandfather was a concert violinist, so he was Austrian, and he was like, und eins, und zwei, und drei, und vier. And finally I was like, and he said, you will never be a violinist, but you will be a conductor. I had that, and he would play me pieces of music, and he said, this is the greatest, and this is, you should listen to, don't listen to them, listen to that. So I grew up with a really strong classical music background. In the meantime, I was, you know, getting into clubs and shaking.
But that's kind of with ballet too, because you have a love and a true understanding of classical ballet.
Yeah.
And from that understanding, you can explore.
Yeah, I don't see, you know, and I see all these things as connected.
Right.
I mean, it's not like I change my body when I go and not do ballet.
Right.
Yeah. So I think that there's a lot of false, what do you say, distinctions made.
Yeah, putting people into camps.
I mean, like, well, it's just dancers. Yeah, I'm just like, it's like, for example, I speak German after, you know, 43 years in Germany. It tends to rub off, yeah. And it's not that the German has not really diminished my English skills. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or learning another language is not necessarily detrimental to your language or your expressive skills. Yeah.
Like, and so you just created a new work for Paris Opera.
Yes.
And could you talk a little bit about that?
Yes. I've been working for the Paris Opera for 33 years. And I started with Rudolf Nureyev, who brought me there.
And what was the first ballet?
France Dance.
Oh.
As I like to pronounce it, France Dance.
France.
Much to the annoyance of everyone at the Paris Opera. I couldn't go France Dance. You know, that would just sound horrible. You know what I mean? So, and that was for a young dancer named Sylvie Guillem, who is this extraordinary ballerina of the last epoch. And she was all of 17 and has just retired at 50. I was like, So I did that, and then Rudolf invited me back, and I made In the Middle.
In the Middle, which people are all familiar with from here.
Which is, thank and you.
It was a real a game changer, I
think. Well, it was, and I discovered when I go to Paris Opera, I realize that they're in this very special system. It's a very unusual thing. And I think what, for myself, what I find it's necessary for me to do is to understand everyone's love for it. Dancers here, these dancers, we all do it because we love it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why do we love it? It's partly the sensation of dancing. Ballet feel, it doesn't look like anything to us. If you're on stage, you can't look like anything. You can only feel like something. And the sensation of ballet is really, I mean, who am I talking to?
No, it's addictive.
Yeah. You come from a generation of addicts.
And it's an expression that you can't find with words.
Or... Yeah, you really can't. It's a way of being that is really unique. It has so many complex, interesting, and beautiful demands at the same time. It's not easy. I was in Paris just now, I was going, okay, it's Olympic. It really is. It's an Olympic profession. Mm-hmm. It really has Olympic challenge. You have to be strong as all get out. Yeah, yeah. You really do. There's no joking around. Either it is or it isn't, and no one's going to make an excuse for you. You know, you can't talk your way out of it. Maybe go, oh yeah, my painting, not to dish the visual arts, but you know, there's a lot of chat around visual arts because I work in the visual arts, and I'm like, you cannot talk your way out of a failed turn. You know what I mean? It really is. But what I'm very interested in is right now at this point in my career is giving dancers, how do you say, I want to give them more and more permission to, when they're on stage, to basically demonstrate how much they love it, yeah, and why it should be here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not that, oh, that people go, oh, ballet, and you're going like, well, if it's really awesome, it's like, oh my God, ballet.
Yeah.
My daughter hated going to ballet. She was like, ugh, like that. And we went to the Kirov together, and they did Don Q. And she was like, why didn't you tell me? It was incredible. It was an insane show, you know, and it was like, yeah.
I remember seeing a piece of yours when I first came to America. It was in San Francisco Ballet, and it was New Sleep.
Oh, right.
And that did that to me.
Oh, cool.
And I remember the dots that they would have, like a dotted string that they would connect so they could see where the dancer was looking. It was fantastic.
It was pretty funny. Yeah.
It was not of anything like I'd seen before.
Yeah.
But Blake's work won.
Blake works won. There's a great young British songwriter, composer named James Blake. Mm-hmm. And he's very classically trained, and you really hear it in his music. The compositions themselves are extraordinary. And I think he's younger than my youngest child. I think he's like 28, yeah? Very thoughtful, very articulate, savvy, and an extraordinary artist, musician. And I heard this music and it was like nothing else I ever heard. In that genre, they call it pop, but I'm like, no, this is something else. It sort of defies classification, because all the fundamental structures all work with ballet. But like, in the contrapuntal sense, yeah, it's extremely densely written music, and the orchestrations they're polyphonic, they're full of a counterpoint. And it lends itself to those wonderful kind of structures that Stan was talking about before that are really fun to make in ballet. It's what you like to watch, too. You're like, oh, right, how is this going to change? Where's it going to go? And ooh, you know, like that. And we like that, too. And it's very challenging to make, I have to say. It doesn't go like that. You know, I mean, it's a lot of You know who I'm talking to.
And is it a large cast? Is it
it's about
as big as Artifact was, or
we're not quite that big. Yeah. I think it's like 24, 5, 6 people, something like that. Big enough. Right. Yeah.
And we're talking a little bit. I had read in a review about that they had a similarity between this piece from till now. And is that an interesting?
It's about everything we love.
Right.
Yeah, and there's certain figures, like the men end up doing the, at one point, the corps de ballet of theme and variations that the girls do.
Oh, right.
You know.
I'd have loved to have done that.
I know, me too. I'm watching, bang. Yeah.
All the four soloists girls. Yeah, yeah, there are some great steps in that combination.
The, yeah, right, right. All the variations, crazy. But we, there was that. There's all, they at one point, they drift through serenade. But in this very, in the last piece, the last duet, they move through all the famous endings of the pas de deux and the great classics. You know, all the guy behind her like this and she's like that and they're both like that and, or opposite and like that. But it keeps morphing through all these epochs, you know.
I love one of the things about you and your work is the sense of port de bras and how important.
Yeah.
And listening to you talk today, and I love the idea of the stretching from one end to the other and how to define the line in the hand and the wrist. And could you talk a little bit about that and how, because that's not what I, as a foreigner, would assume you'd see in New York. That seems to be you, a unique.
Yeah. Well, I think it's from observing really great ballerinas. I guess they picked up a part of history, and you sort of go like, wow, that's so beautiful. And then you have to go, after that's so beautiful, you have to go like, how does that work? Mm-hmm. Your professional plumber self kicks in, and you're like, you know, oh, okay. And like that, you know. And so what I like is I like when a lot of the articulation, so if dancers sing with their bodies, I think that a great deal comes from about here and moves through all these various, angular states of the hand, you know, all this stuff. But I think the hand has to express, so if you're doing something, the hand has to express all the torsion you're feeling. So ballet is a series of counter torsions like this, right? Bum, bum, e, hum, bum. And so if the hand finally expresses from here to here the end of all that and the end of all that, you get the whole thing is the position, not just the leg and an arm. You get the entire body living the position.
And it's that growth that looks so great, that length.
Yeah.
And you see it in the middle of the first, every stretch, every pull in the pas de deux.
The middle's a bit extreme.
And was that the counterbalance between the partnering? I mean, that seems that you have to have a great deal of trust with one another, and they're constantly gambling with that as they get through the pas. And you see it a lot in artifact in the pas de deux. Yeah. They're really hard, intense, hard. Classical dancing.
I think that they're both both the man and the woman are trying to make something. Mm-hmm. It's not like the woman has to do this stuff and the guy is like, I'm helping you make this. No, they are making something together. And I think the most important thing they could do would be to form partnerships. Like, you know, like, let's make something together. Right. As okay, I'm behind you and I'm gonna help you and, you know, like that. And I say to the guys, whatever she's doing, you have to want it more than her. Yeah, and you're going to do everything in your power to make it maybe beyond what she thought she could do. Just that kind of partnering, I think, is really inspiring for the woman, you know, because then she feels enabled. Yeah. But he has to know the choreography, what she's trying to do, as well as she does. Yeah, but, yeah.
There's one very special woman in the ballet who starts in the front.
Could you
explain her?
Yeah, I had this epiphany that basically ballet is a lot about copying. It doesn't come from a vacuum, right? All of us had to stand there and back of someone and go, like that, right? We all had that moment.
Yeah.
I'm teaching at a university now and people who are incredible hip hop dancers but never had ballet. It's very interesting starting from zero, teaching people from zero. I'm usually only working with people who have already hit 100. And it's really interesting to say, what is it? And my sentence to them, the key sentence to the people who had no ballet and are supposed to learn it in a year, flow and rotate. So just think about that. I might see you next year upstairs.
And then I learned a new word in preparing for this. Sisura? No, I'm sorry.
Sisura.
Sisura. Could you explain that? Because I think it's such an impactful...
Okay. In the second act, you will not be surprised because I'm telling you about this, okay? Dance is going on, boom, boom, jump, giant corps de ballet, soloist, music, lights, shim, boom, curtain comes down in the middle of it. Everyone's like, did someone injure themselves? Is something wrong? Nothing's wrong. It's the end of a section of music. Don't forget, I'm musically trained. And there have been the most idiotic theories written about this. You cannot imagine the amount of ink that has been wasted.
Oh,
and no one seems to like go. And some musician said, it's musical. I was like, thank you.
Well, that's why I love it. It's so straightforward.
I was like, so it's basically the end of a musical chapter. And then it goes back up. Okay, so there's no mystery there. Okay, for
and
you.
The two, in between the two dance.
Wait, and I would like it if you would discuss it loudly in the intermission. I noticed that the music...
Could you tell us about the middle piece that's played in reverse?
Oh yeah, that's just the music of the chaconne. It's just played in backwards, yeah.
It was just finding other angles to come at the music? What was the...
I was just trying to figure a way to make it like less boring waiting for the lights and costume to change and like that, you know?
One of the great things too is you really are so involved in the lighting and the costuming and the scenic element.
Yeah.
Would you talk a little bit about that?
Necessity is the mother of invention. we had in Europe, we had great funding, but it was enough for dancers' salaries, which is the most important, or staff, everyone's salaries, which is the most important thing. Everything else was up for grabs, and they don't have fundraising like we have here. Money is not raised. It's simply, if you have government funding, that's it. It's changing now, slowly. But there was not money for other stuff. I had technicians at a house, but no designers. Like, oh, no, we can't afford that. So I basically had to do everything.
And it's but great. I love that it's
learning by doing.
Yeah, and it's become such a part of what we see from you.
There's a very funny story about art. The second part, at one point you'll notice there are these lights and they're very low and they're only focused on the floor. That's because we were in Italy doing part of it, and I was doing all the lighting, and I was like this, moving the light, and I went, and I went, light went, and I was like, I'll try the other one. Next one. Same stuff. All the lights were broken. So I just ended up focusing all the lights on the floor, and that's how that cue came about, out of necessity.
Yeah, but I love that it's part of the organism, the living part of the show.
Yeah.
And we've also got a really great thing that's coming up for us and for you. We were asked by Billy to go to LA and perform with part of three companies in a festival all about Mr. Forsythe. And we will, yes.
Yeah, isn't that, I'm really happy. Thanks.
And we will get to perform Artifact there alongside San Francisco Ballet, which has been a company that you've worked with for many years, and Pacific Northwest Ballet. So it's very exciting for all of us, and thank you very much.
It's like it's like the Dance Olympics.
It is.
It's like, woo, it's going to be a hot evening.
Do you want to talk about because it's beyond just us, it's beyond just the dancing. It's celebrated in many, in photography and visual arts.
Visual arts stuff that I do, and I think doing costume exhibition is a bunch of. I do stuff, on the web.
Did you choose the program, or how did the picking the ballets come about?
I picked the program.
Right.
Yeah. I wanted you all.
Could you talk about what that whole evening may be?
It's. I would say focusing on neoclassical works.
Right.
Yeah. Three different views of the same thing. So this is more or less 84. Tweaked for 30 years,
right.
1984. Then Vertiginous was around 96.
Which we've done here.
Yeah, Green Tutus.
Yeah.
Yeah. People gagging at the end. Poor dancers. Yeah. And then Pop Hearts, which is the work I made after In the Middle for Paris Opera.
All right.
And which San Francisco was the first company to ever do it. after its premiere. Yeah, 16 years later. But I made an entirely new version for San Francisco.
Okay.
So I kept the music and the idea of the structure, but I changed about 85% of the steps. Mm-hmm. So
all the ballets are always evolving.
Why not?
Yes.
I mean, I am, so why not?
Well, thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks, Danny. Thank you, honey.
I'm going to say one.
Yeah.
And it really is a great honor to have someone of Billy's caliber here working with the dancers. I'm sure that they're all as thrilled as we are.
I'm thrilled
and
too.
What an inspiration you are to all of us.
Oh, thanks.
And thank you.
Thanks, baby. Thanks a lot. Thank you.